But first, our series on antibiotics and the dangerous so-called superbugs building resistance to them. It's a joint project from our science correspondent, Miles O'Brien, and our economics correspondent, Paul Solman. Last night, Miles looked at the clear and present dangers for patients. Tonight, we start tackling the hunt for new drugs and why the market for creating them has just about collapsed. Here is Paul's report. It's part of our weekly series, Making Sense.
So, Russian emigre, 1989, came here speaking no English. How do you like capitalism?
I embraced it.
Slava Epstein has been embracing novelty his entire life. Told he'd never make it as an astrophysicist in the former Soviet Union, he swapped telescope for microscope and became a biologist instead. Then, unable to find an academic job upon emigrating to the U.S., he volunteered at university labs while doing odd jobs to survive.
Painting houses takes no English. Repairing roofs does not require much of English. Paving driveways with bricks is a silent job.
And nearly 30 years later, Epstein is still getting his hands dirty, looking for new antibiotics.
1 gram of dirt like this contains roughly, give or take, 10 billion cells.
As he told my colleague Miles O'Brien,
1% has been more or less explored. The remaining 9.9 billion cells per gram have not.
Now, digging up dirt is actually a grand old tradition in antibiotics research.
100,000 samples of soil to be scientifically searched for a life-saving organism.
A project made that much more urgent by the onset of World War II and the wounded soldiers who filled England's hospitals.
Chambers of horrors seem the best way to describe those septic wards.
MARIE-LOUISE Kerr of the History of Science Museum in Oxford, where penicillin was developed into a drug.
But by the end of World War II, penicillin is a key factor in the Allies winning the war, right?
Definitely. America was able to produce penicillin on a much larger scale. And yes, by 1944, 45, there was enough penicillin to treat every soldier involved in D-Day, and also civilians as well.
But just 2 years after that, penicillin-resistant staph infections were already being reported, a pattern that's been repeated for every antibiotic since.
Resistance arises very quickly to antibiotics. It really, in clinical use, it takes just a few years.
Now, this wasn't much of a problem during the so-called golden age of antibiotic discovery and development. But that age has been over for decades.
The last time that we had a new class of gram-negative antibiotics approved for human use, that drug was discovered the year that I was born, 1962. So we've had no new classes discovered in my entire lifetime.
Boston University law professor Kevin Otterson specializes in health law.
So these drugs worked well for our parents and grandparents' generation, but they won't work that way forever. Resistance will undermine them. We have to replace them.
Okay, clear enough. As today's antibiotics begin to lose their oomph, a clear and present danger lurks. But here's where prudent medicine runs into the hard truths of economics.
Early on, you bring in a new drug that goes one bacterium further, so to speak. Everybody say, you know, I really need that. I need it today. I'm going to start using that today.
Dr. John Rex is a former pharmaceutical industry executive.
But now you invent a new antibiotic that hits the very most resistant bacteria in the world. What we as a community want you to do with it is sit on it, okay, and save it for just that rainy day.
That's because the last thing we want to do as a society is use a new super drug too soon, spurring the evolution of super drug resistant bugs that will eventually render the new drug worthless.
So then the increasing awareness of the overuse or potential overuse of an antibiotic because it will create resistance makes the economics worse?
It does, and also our awareness that of how hard it is to find them. So once we found this precious jewel, we need to protect it because every use of an antibiotic, even a correct use, drives resistance.
This isn't a question of if this is a problem, it's when.
John Rex and Kevin Otterson are both working on a new project called CARB-X. A public-private partnership to spur development of new antibiotics because the market just can't do the job by itself. After all, Why would a drug company spend a fortune developing a new antibiotic when no responsible doctor will prescribe it until there's no alternative?
From the company perspective, it's a disaster because their novel, cutting-edge, exciting product doesn't sell.
And it's a product in which they've presumably invested a huge amount of capital.
Hundreds of millions of dollars.
Meanwhile, the patent that keeps any other company from making and selling a generic version runs out after only 14 years.
Two of the most highly used antibiotics in the United States, last-ditch antibiotics, are colistin and vancomycin. And both of them have been off patent for decades. At the time that they entered the market, we had better drugs. Now we need them, right? So this is a classic example of, if it's useful, it's saved for the future, which makes the commercial prospects very difficult.
Another problem. For a relatively rare infection, a company might have to charge tens or even hundreds of thousands of dollars to get a return on its investment.
And you see that for cancer.
Right.
It's impossible to do that for antibiotics.
Why not?
We lack the diagnostics that would tell the doctor immediately that this antibiotic is the one that would save this person's life.
As if all that weren't enough of an economic disincentive for investing in new antibiotics, infectious disease specialist Lindsay Baden points out yet another one, length of treatment.
Often the treatments are short, a week or two, and intermittent. And that's very different than for hypertension, diabetes, hypercholesterol, where it's a treatment every day for the rest of your life.
So does that mean that the market, as currently constructed, can't come up with new antibiotics? There just won't be the investment to make in them?
We won't get the sort of antibiotics we really need. What about the antibiotic that saves the life and returns you to full health of somebody who's 20 or 30 or 40? That antibiotic is worth, truthfully, millions of dollars. In any other field, there would be venture capitalists running around funding these preclinical ideas. For antibiotics, because there's no big payday at the end, the business model is broken, there's very little private capital.
So how does society change the economics to solve a problem that could be as important to the future of humanity as any?
Well, I happen to be an optimist.
That's where Slava Epstein comes in.
An incurable optimist.
Yes, still dancing to his own beat. And while it still takes two to tango, Epstein's eternal optimism is all his own.
The probability of overwhelming success is over 100%.
Well, 100% seemed a tad high to both me and Miles O'Brien. Is Slava Epstein a piece of work or not? And I use that phrase in the best possible sense.
Absolutely, and he would not be offended. But his optimism, I wonder about. Now, you're the expert on the invisible hand, although I have a certain amount of expertise in this myself, but let's put that aside. Everybody I've spoken to along the way on this says this just cries out for some government intervention.
Yeah, and that's where we're going with the next story. How does government get involved when the market can't seem to solve a problem, as is the case here? For the PBS NewsHour, I'm economics correspondent Paul Solman.
And I'm science correspondent Miles O'Brien.